Hey everybody, Joe Lowry, what a day, and my guest at this time really needs no introduction, but she's going to get one anyways. She's a former two-time TNA Impact Knockouts champion and tag team champion. She's appeared at Ring of Honor, Lucha Libre, AAA Worldwide, and she is currently on the announce team for NWA Power, as seen on Tuesday nights. So let's give a warm what a day welcome to the lovely, talented, and beautiful Miss Velvet Sky.
Well, hello, Joe. What a day.
Awesome. That's awesome. Let's just jump right in here. You know, we're turning the corner on the pandemic. You know, hopefully it's in our rearview mirror soon enough. Shows are starting again. Live events are starting again. How was it that NWA Power landed Velvet Sky for their announce team?
Well, it's more like, how was it that Velvet Sky landed NWA as part of their announce team? I mean, this is it's a really, really cool experience for me because, you know, my experience in the wrestling business only comes from inside the ring, you know, right, mixing it up in with the action in the ring. So to actually be on the other side of the ring, where at this point in my life, I prefer to be on that side of the ring because my body's like, no more. It's really, really cool. So Billy Corgan, he's the president of the NWA, as everybody knows, and he requested me specifically for the commentator role. So when I got the call, I was just like, whoa, Billy Corgan, Smashing Pumpkins. Like, I was like fangirling, like, oh my God. And it's cool because Billy is such a really, he's a really, really cool, talented, super talented, like down to earth guy. Awesome. And I worked with him briefly in TNA. He was in TNA for a cup of coffee because people come in TNA when they deal with Dixie Carter, they're like, okay, no more. Bye bye. He wasn't there that long, unfortunately. I worked with him briefly in TNA when I came back as like that badass Velvet role before I retired. He kind of helped me work on my character and just gave me like tips and pointers just for character stuff and, you know, what he thought would work for me. So fast forward all these years later, and now I'm working for him at the NWA. And it's like I said, it's really, really surreal to be in the role that I'm in because I've never done commentating.
Right.
I'm still, you know, obviously brand new at it. The last tapings were my first go at commentating. So, you know, I have a lot to learn, and I will only get better as I go. But it's just been, it was really, really cool to, you know, get that phone call and be a part of the announce team with Tim Storm and Joe Galley.
Right. Now, if I wasn't impressed before, I am now. I didn't know Billy Corgan actually reached out to you for that. But that's awesome. That's really, really good. Now, you're obviously a very talented athlete. I've read you've done some cheerleading, football, softball, cross country, all that good stuff, track. Do you feel that participating early on in those types of athletic competitions prepared you better for the world of pro wrestling?
Oh, absolutely. That's kind of what made me want to pursue pro wrestling as a career. Okay. I played sports, oh my God, all my 7 years old, I started softball. And then
in middle, young. I got three of my own. They're all grown up, so I know,
So baseball kind of runs in my family anyways. My dad was supposed to, like, he was getting scouted, and he was, like, supposed to play for the Cincinnati Reds. But that was the time where he ended up getting drafted to Vietnam. My dad is an excellent ball player. My mom played softball. My whole family pretty much plays baseball, softball. So my parents got me into it at a very young age. So I played recreational for my town when I was seven, and then middle school. All sports in middle school was softball and cheerleading, and then high school it was softball, track, cross country, and cheerleading. So I've always been like athletic. I've always like excelled in athletic, you know,
that's
sports.
Awesome.
After I graduated high school, I was like, oof, no more sports. What am I going to do? You know? So I went to college for like a year and a half, and every day I'm sitting in class and I'm like, I don't belong here. I don't belong here. I want to wrestle. I want to wrestle. I want to wrestle. So I left college after a year and a half. I moved back home with my parents, which, you know, at that age, you're kind of trying to move out on your own. But I moved back home because there was a wrestling school in my hometown here in Connecticut that I found. And I just went there and I sat in on a few sessions just to kind of watch how things went. And that was kind of my first taste at like wrestling up close like that. I mean, I would go to WWF events as a kid, like when I was younger, but like actually go to a wrestling school and kind of see the behind the scenes and how everything works. I was like, all right, you know what? This is for me. So yeah, to answer your question, having an athletic background definitely works in one's favor if you're going to pursue a professional wrestler. If you don't have an athletic background, you're not going to get very far, I should say.
True. Like, that is true. But I know a lot of people, I mean, coming from a coach's standpoint and all that, I've had multiple athletes I've coached and so forth. And it's tough making a transition, never mind from one sport to another, but from one industry to the other. So that's why I kind of ask, because a lot of people say, yeah, I played pro sports, whatever. I can wrestle, no problem. They get in the ring and they're like, freeze. So I kind of like throw that out there. But, you know, we all know you're retired from active in-ring competition, but I got to ask, is there any time that you've gotten out of bed and looked at one person, whether it's a male or female, and said, I think I'd like to get back in the ring one more time and face that person? And if so, who would that be?
No. No.
And wow. No. Okay.
Reason being is like, I have a messed up neck. My neck and my spine are all screwed up. I have bulges and herniations, and I have functional scoliosis. Okay. No, structural. I don't remember if it's functional or structural. Pretty much my time in the ring, I wrestled for 16 years.
Right.
Pretty much every weekend. And then in TNA, sometimes it was like every week, depending on when we did pay-per-views, house shows, like live events, whatever the case may be. So I retired in 2016 from in-ring action. I love the business. Right. I always wanted to stay active in the business in one way or another. I didn't care if I just was doing autograph signings. But I walked away in 2016 because I felt like, it was at a point in time where management and TNA was everyone's, like, no one was on board with management. Like, everyone was miserable at that point.
So morale issues and all that stuff. Okay.
Yeah. And my contract was coming to an end, and I wasn't having fun anymore. I was always very grateful for the opportunities given and for my time in TNA. But because of manager problems and, just all the BS that comes with that, my contract was coming to an end. I wasn't happy anymore. And I'm like, you know what? I feel good. I feel healthy. My body feels great. I'm like, now is a better time than never to just walk away from in-ring action. Because I've seen guys and girls in the industry, they don't know when to hang the boots up. And what ends up happening is they'll end up getting an injury that makes them have to hang the boots up. I've seen that enough where I'm like, I don't want to be that person. Right. So I'm not going to push my body to the limit to where oh my God, I'm so hurt. I have to quit. Now I have to walk away. So when I left, I was like, I feel great. I feel wonderful. 2 years later, 2 years, 2.5 years later, December of 2018 is when I started to develop pain in my neck and in my spine and everything. And I'm like, oh Jesus. So I've been to doctor after doctor after doctor, blah, 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 blah. No one has really been able to do anything for me as far as pain goes and getting my spine kind of back in line and stuff. But I'm seeing a chiropractor now. He's helped me tremendously. I'm still in a lot of pain on a daily basis, but I could never take another bump again in my life, even if I wanted to.
And obviously this is all attributed to in-ring wear and tear over the years.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Right. There was not one isolated bump or incident that led me to this pain. It's like when you bump, week in and week out for as long as I have, what happens is your poor body, if your spine's supposed to be straight, and then after a while, it just starts to pivot, and your body starts to spine, it starts to appear this is normal posture. So it's not. So when my chiropractor tries to put me back in line straight, I get adjusted, but then right after I get adjusted, it's like, nope, this is not normal. We're going back to how we think is normal. It's like wearing braces. If you get braces, you know what I mean? The braces are going to help your teeth. But when you take the braces off, what do you have to wear? A retainer. Right. If you don't wear the retainer, they're going to go back to being messed up and stuff. It's the same with chiropractic care. And unfortunately,
I totally understand. Injuries are huge in this industry and all that. Well, there goes my next question, because you said no, I'm only kidding. Hypothetically speaking, what do you, not hypothetically speaking, you answered the question honestly, I appreciate that. What are your thoughts on the state of women's wrestling now compared to when you were in the ring and so forth? And I'm talking back in 2013 and so forth, when you were ranked, what is it, number 11 top 50 in PWI, 50 females.
Oh, was I? Okay.
Compare that era to now. Do you think women's wrestling has transcended, or is it starting to trend again?
No, I feel like women's wrestling has come a long way, especially right. since I started in the business in 2001, 2002. Right. It's definitely come a long way. The women out there are absolutely killing it. They're doing a great job. I don't watch as much wrestling anymore as I used to, so I couldn't tell you kind of like who's doing what with who and what company. I try to, you know, keep up with it when I can. But right. the only thing, like, and this is just my opinion. It's just my opinion, okay? I came up in the business, well, not in the business. I came up on wrestling as a fan during the Attitude Era.
Sure.
You know, where it was Sable, like the Sables and the Tori Wilsons and the Sexy and the Glitz and the Glamour.
Wasn't much wrestling going on, that's for sure. Well, but I know what you're saying.
Well, there wasn't, but I mean, there were matches, you know, where Luna wrestled and Sable wrestled and Miss Jackie wrestled and China, you know, there was that mixture of women's wrestling. It wasn't as mainstream as it is today, but like I watched Sable and I was like, wow, this woman's beautiful. And she can go in the ring. She can hold her own. Wow. Yeah. Tori Wilson. So I kind of came up on like, you know, like the Sexy, like, as far as mixing the Sexy with the athleticism. So, you know, that's kind of like where Angelina Love and I, like, we both were huge fans of the Attitude Era. So when we formed the Beautiful People in TNA, it was just like we took that combination of like Sexy, which is okay. It's okay to be sexy in wrestling. It's okay to be sexy in life. It's okay to embrace your sexuality or your sexiness or whatever. So the Beautiful People, it was just a mixture of like Sexy and athleticism. So I feel like I know with the whole women's movement thing going on in the world and in wrestling, they're trying to like, I guess, take away that Sexy because they feel like it just demoralizes women. That's where I disagree. It's okay to be sexy. It's okay. And I feel like that's what's missing in women's wrestling. Not that women's wrestling needs that, but my opinion, I miss that, like the days of just like, ooh, just embracing your sexiness while also being a superior women athlete. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, see, it's definitely a generational thing. You go from Attitude Era. I think the WWE is struggling right now. Their ratings show that. Creative is collapsing. There's just not, everyone's missing that element. And, you know, you said the Beautiful People and so forth. Now, I've seen online and podcasts in the past where, you know, everyone asks you why, if you went to WWE, what would you do? And you were like, I don't think I want to go to WWE.
Because that would be ruined.
They'd be control the creative and all that stuff. And obviously, you're not the first one to talk like that, because I had Maria Kanellis on over the summer and she had just gotten released and she had one of the biggest storylines. And all of a sudden, it was like, boom, no storyline. But that is how business is now. It's like, it doesn't matter if it's making $1 million. I don't think they want to make another huge star again, like The Rock or Stone Cold or something like that, because they're just satisfied with whatever they have now. Now, as a fan, I'm like, well, this blows. Like, I can't stand this. Like, I miss the Attitude Era. I'm a historian, so I've seen multiple generations of wrestling, and the Attitude Era by far, even though some things were very risque or whatever, it still put them on the map. It's what put them into that entertainment crescendo and so forth. So I always ask that question, you know, if you went there, would you be okay with that? Obviously, probably not, because you'd be controlled creatively and so forth. And you have that more freedom in TNA and all that stuff. And
back in the day as a young wrestler, I mean, that's every wrestler's dream when you're getting in the business to make it to WWE. And it was a lot different back then. So of course, when I got in the business, my aspirations and goals were like, ooh, I want to make it there. I want to make it there. When I got to TNA and Angelina and I kind of formed the Beautiful People, it was like, wow, okay, that's why WWE was never meant to be for either one of us, because we were supposed to be in TNA doing the Beautiful People. We made a name for ourselves, like coming from the independent scene. We were like the homegrown talent, one of the highest rated acts on the show. So we didn't need WWE at that point.
Right. You know what I mean? Right.
Yep. And it's like, we were totally fine with that. I'm fine to this day. And I know she is too, because we've talked about it. Like, we're both like so like fine with not going there. Like in the past before TNA, it was like, oh damn, right. You know, you go to tryouts, you know, WWE takes you on this like emotional roller coaster ride where it's like one day they're like, ooh, maybe, yeah, contract. Yeah. And then the next day it's like, maybe not. And then it's like, ooh. So I was like always like this with them. I would go get the call for like multiple tryouts or just to be an extra or to come do pre-tapes. And like, you know, I did well every time. I got a really good feedback from like people there, and it was just like, and I'm like, you know what, screw this shit, screw this. Like, they like to play mind games with people. They like to like mentally mind F you. Right. And TNA, they don't do that at TNA. TNA, they let you be you. They let you, they give you the ball and it's like, hey, here's the ball, sink or swim.
Right. Like I said, you're not the only one to say that. I mean, there's a lot of people even right now sitting in catering going, I wish I was doing something else. And it's a shame because, you know, your goal is to get to the big show. And, you know, now there's more than one big show. Let's be honest out there. It's not just about WWE anymore because, you know, with the pandemic, if anything, it's helped people get into social media a lot more and find out there is Impact Wrestling, there is NWA Power, you know, there is all these other avenues to AEW. I'd be remiss if I didn't say that. So there's more avenues now. It's not just WWE controlled anymore. Right. And I think that, that transition we're going through right now where, you know, we have a choice now and people are making that choice and they're not going to the to regular WWE anymore. So do you feel you're a trailblazer of some sorts? You were in that timeline where, you know, you mentioned some greats, China, Sable, all them. They were around when you were around and, you know, Medusa, all those girls, do you feel you can be, you're up there with them like that?
Well, I don't want to put myself on a pedestal. I'm very humble. And I think that's in the most humble of ways what I'm about to say, but yes, I feel like not just myself, I feel like all of the knockouts that started the knockouts division back in 2007, we were all trailblazers for women's wrestling.
Sure. Yep.
Because while we were actually wrestling, we were doing sexy stuff too. Angelina and I, it was part of our character, the beautiful people. So again, the sexiness and the wrestling, but I feel like all the girls, the knockouts from 2007 that started the division, we were all trailblazers because while we were wrestling, WWE had their girls doing brown panties matches and jello matches and pudding matches and blah, 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 blah. I'm not taking a crap on that and saying there's anything wrong with that. And, or I'm not judging them for it, but like, we kind of set the bar for women's wrestling. And when WWE took notice, and these are facts, like this is my opinion, what I'm saying now.
I know where you're headed with this, but yes, I get that. Yep. Go ahead.
So while, you know, the knockouts were over here making history and, you know, we're the highest rated acts on the show. And Vince Russo, like once he caught wind that like, he was all about like in the ratings, like, oh my God, like clockwork. Like every week it was like, okay, ratings. Who got the highest? And the girls always had the highest ratings.
Right.
So Vince Russo would be like, all right, you know what? We have, I don't even know how many, there were a lot of girls at first, maybe 10, 15. Right. He found a way to incorporate all the girls on the show every week, whether it was like tag matches, six woman tag matches, pre-tapes in the back, in rings, managing. We were all on the show because Vince knew what was making the numbers spike.
You go so, what works, right, exactly. Right.
So WWE, once they caught on, because I mean, the knockouts were the talk of the wrestling world. We definitely were, I'm sorry. Like, that's just the way it's facts. WWE caught on to see how successful and how popular the knockouts were. They felt like, oof, we need to like really have our like girls like up their game a little bit. We can't have them doing this fluff and utter stuff anymore.
Right.
So that's when they started to like try to like make their girls, you know, be more serious. Be taken more serious. Excuse me.
Right.
And it did. It started with knockouts, and those are facts.
Nope. I agree. I agree wholeheartedly. What would your advice be to women out there that are trying to pursue what you've done in the past? I mean, at least following those footsteps, so to speak. What would your advice be to them?
Okay. So first and foremost, again, real quick, this is part of me answering the question. I went to college before I got into wrestling and a huge wrestling fan at the time. But then I was only 19. So I'm like, okay, I can leave school and go do this, what I want to do. Right. My dream as a wrestler, because I'm so young. And when you're that young, your body's very versatile. You can kind of bounce back from a lot of things that, like, you wouldn't be able to bounce back to if you started to wrestle at 40. At 50.
You don't have to tell me that.
Well, yeah. So I left school because I'm like, I can come back to school when I'm 40, when I'm 50, when I'm 60. But you can't start training for wrestling. You can, but you shouldn't start training for wrestling when you're 40, 50, whatever. Because your body is just like, nope. And it will tell you no. So my advice would be start at a young enough age if you're serious about it. Like, don't just be like, oh, it's just a hobby. It's just a hobby. Because it's really not. Like, you're screwing your body up. So you have to be really, really serious that, like, this is what you're trying to pursue as a career. If you want it to just be a hobby, then, you know, more power to you. You're kind of like killing your body for no reason other than, you know, just being a hobby. But have a backup plan for sure. Start when you're young enough where, you know, you have that shelf life, you have that longevity. Wrestlers have bump cards, and you only have so many bumps on your bump cards before your body craps out.
Heard that before.
Yeah. So, but always have a backup plan. I went back to school after. Actually, no, I was in wrestling still. I took online college courses in 2014, 2 years before I retired from in-ring action, because I'm like, all right, I'm not gonna be able to wrestle forever. Right. I'm not gonna wrestle until, like, my body just shits the bed on me, and, like, then I'm like, uh-oh, now what? I can't wrestle anymore. What do I do now for a career? How am I going to pay my bills? So have that backup plan.
Sure.
You know, like, have That's something awesome. In mind that, like, don't expect wrestling to just, like, take you for the rest of your life, because whether you make it or you don't make it big, you have to have something else to fall back on once you hang up the boots.
That's awesome.
And it comes with a lot of sacrifices, which is what people that get into the business at first, they don't realize.
Right.
You're sacrificing pretty much your whole life, pretty much at first, with training and trying to get your name out there and trying to make shows every weekend. I mean, I sacrificed so many, like, holidays and family get-togethers and birthdays.
That is the biggest misconception. I mean, some of these people, I mean, pre-pandemic and hopefully coming up later, most people are on the road 200-300 days a year.
Yeah.
They're missing out. I mean, we may see them on TV once a week and think that's it, but these people are traveling. I mean, I have a lot of friends in the industry. I know, you know, it's like you miss out on stuff, little things, birthdays, anniversaries, all that stuff. And that does add up mentally. I have to ask you, I meant to ask you at the beginning, Velvet Sky, how did you come up with that name?
That was not a name that I chose. when you sign a contract with a company, wrestling company, when I signed my contract with TNA, they pretty much own your likes and the rights to your name and stuff like that. Okay. So my independent name was Talia Madison. And when I signed my contract, they owned my name and my rights and the likes to my whatever. Okay. So Vince Russo came up with the name Velvet Sky. And I remember, like, when I first learned what my name was, I could have cried my eyes out. I was like, my name is what? You're calling me what? I'm like, it sounds like a porn star name. And I'm like, okay, I'm over here. Like,
that's the sexy part, right?
Well, there's the sexy part, but it was just kind of odd at first. I'm like, man, I don't like this name. I don't like it. I don't like it. I don't. But then, like, the more, you know, like, my career went on with TNA and, it really grew on me to the point where I'm like, I love my name now because it's very unique. There's really not, like, another name out there like it, instead of just being like a Betty or a Jennifer or, like, not that there's anything wrong with those names. It's just, like, it's an unforgettable name. It's different, and I'm different, and I like different, and it's weird, and I'm weird, and I like weird, so it works.
It's a name you'll never forget. I mean, there's only one Velvet Sky. I mean, there's Red Velvet and AEW, but there's only one Velvet Sky, and that's you.
Right.
That's awesome. I know we're running out of time here, but what's next? Are we, hopefully, like I said, we're turning the corner on the pandemic and so forth. Appearances, NWA stuff. Tell everybody out there what's next for Velvet Sky.
Well, I am currently with the NWA full time as a commentator with Tim Storm and Joe Galli. We have our next pay per view on June 6th, where people, you guys can watch it on Fight TV. It's an app, you have to download it. The pay per views are on there. Our TV shows air every Tuesday at 6:05 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Again, by downloading the Fight TV app, you just search NWA Power with three R's and you subscribe. I believe it's for something a month or a I don't want to say the wrong things, but
I think it's like $4.99 a month or something
which is really but it's great because it's such good wrestling. Like, it was my first time in the NWA, being in the atmosphere, being in that locker room. Everyone is so cool. It's like a big family. Everyone looks out for one another. I mean, the wrestlers there, the guys, the girls, they are superior athletes. So to sit at that desk and just kind of watch them and call the action, it's like, wow, these guys and these girls, they are amazing at what they do. And I truly believe it's the best wrestling like I've seen out there. And I'm not just saying that because I'm with the company.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. When NWA Power started, was it last year or the year before? That old school ring and audience, and that is the stuff. See, I grew up in the Northeast. I was regulated to WWF programming, but when cable came around, all of a sudden I started getting Mid-South wrestling and all this. Yeah. And that's the kind of set that I used to watch. And to see that nowadays is awesome. And I love it. And that's what attracts me to NWA Power, too, to watch that because of that.
And I'm super old school too. So, like, old school anything. And I like that old school vibe that the NWA brings to the table. Yeah. So what's next for me? Yes, I will be commentating, thankfully, full time with them. I'm very, very grateful for that opportunity. Like I said, I'm still really new at it. I have a lot to learn and I will get better as I go.
You're doing a great job. You're doing a great job.
Thank you. And I'm just starting to get back out there and take bookings again for signings. I had health setbacks in 2019 and 2020. But with the pandemic in 2020, there weren't a whole lot of public appearances going on anyway. So I have a virtual signing coming up. I have a bunch of signings coming up in May, something in June. So I am getting myself back out there in the mix, in the groove, meeting fans, because meeting the fans, doing the meet and greets, the autograph signings, that's really my favorite part of what I do. So,
well, we love you on social media because that video the other day of you on the toilet and the door knocking, that was really great.
I'm such a freaking nerd, man. Like, TikTok, I think I found my calling in TikTok because it's like,
oh my God, I think everybody has.
It's so funny. I like doing the funny things on there. I mean, there's sexy content on there. Maybe I'll get into
there's
that too.
I
feel like my TikTok just shows like the humorous side of Velvet Sky, where like my Instagram and my Twitter, you know, it shows a mixture of like sexy and sometimes humorous, but like TikTok is like the humorous side of me.
I love it. So social media, you're a big presence on there. Why don't you let the WhattaDay fans know how they can get a hold of you on social media if they don't already know?
Okay, so you can follow me on Twitter at VelVelHoller. My TikTok is tiktok.com/@VelVelHoller. And my Instagram is @SkyIsVelvet. And I have an online store because a lot of people always ask me, where can I get autograph pictures of you or merchandise? So you can go to ratedv.net and there's tons of like pictures and merchandise for me. That's my store. I own it. I run it. I ship everything. I sign everything personally, ships worldwide, all that good stuff.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, I want to thank you for taking the time out of your busy day to come and chat with WhattaDay and so forth. I wish you the best of luck, especially with NWA Power. You're doing a great job, color thank commentator. You have that in-ring experience. You're bringing that to the table and to NWA. And, you know, my best wishes to you and everybody else. And I hope you stay safe during the pandemic.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it. Have a great day.
All right. Thanks for joining us. Hey, everybody. I'm Joe Lowry. What a day.
What a day.